didn't know how to do that very well for my own business. I didn't know how to do that well enough to help somebody else. But my revenue for my company struggled and struggled and struggled. And I could have even just $100,000 of revenue for 10 years solid. I could have had more than that. You know, do the math, the revenue that I could have been generating for my company, if only I had, instead of quailing from and running from the idea of what sales really was all about, if I had learned that art for my own company a lot sooner.
Hi, I'm Emily Harmon, host of the Onward podcast. My guest today is Judy Bradt. Judy is my friend, and she's also a consultant in the government contracting space. However, this episode isn't just for people who are in the government contracting space. It's for anybody who's engaged in sales. And if you think, oh, well, I don't sell anything for a business, I still recommend that you listen because, you know, in this episode, I talk about how even my five-year-old grandson is in sales because he's influencing other people. He tries to influence his parents to understand his point of view. So we are all at some point in our lives, in some point throughout the day, engaged in sales. In this episode, Judy shares how she overcame a multimillion-dollar mistake and how she helps other business owners do the same. She's a micro-engagement maven who discovered the key to joy in entrepreneurship, and that key is human connection. Furthermore, selling is one of the most poorly understood and loathed aspects of entrepreneurship. I agree with that. And Judy knows because she struggled with and did everything possible to avoid sales for over 25 years. Ultimately, Judy faced her greatest fears and she discovered what she had been missing. You don't have to let this happen to you. Judy shares what she learned and how you can change your experience and outcomes with sales. This Onward podcast episode and all of my episodes are brought to you by my coaching business, Emily Harmon Coaching and Consulting. And Judy was one of my clients. In fact, I coached her in the area of mental fitness. And in the show notes, I left a link to a video testimonial that Judy did about how mental fitness helped her with improving her sleep. And then that ultimately improved her performance at work, in leading her company, and with her relationships. So check out her video that she did about the benefits of that mental fitness, or some people call it positive intelligence coaching program. Let's get to the interview. Hi, Judy. We are live. So welcome to the Onward podcast.
It's so exciting to be here after hearing all your amazing guests. I can't believe I'm really here.
Oh, well, I can. I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say. I mean, I love the title that you selected for this, Multimillion Dollar Mistake to Micro Engagement Maven and Discovering the Joy, the Key to Joy in Entrepreneurship. And I think your mistake was in the area of sales, which is something that, you know, I think a lot of us are like, oh, I don't know about sales. So I'm looking forward to learning from you.
Well, I'm looking forward to sharing where I am on the journey. I wish I could tell you I had it all nailed down. What I can tell you is a little bit about the journey I was on and the couple of turning points that were a really big, hairy deal and made all the difference.
Okay, awesome. I'm looking forward to hearing it because, you know, the Onward podcast, sometimes people are like, well, I didn't have a severe adversity, you know, and I don't want to compare adversities one to another. I mean, you know, there's all different kinds of adversities that we have in life. And yours is something that I think a lot of us can relate to, which is, you know, the, kind of being a little nervous about sales. So you don't have that anymore, though.
Every day. It's just like when you hear people talk about public speaking and you hear people who are really, really good at public speaking or actors say that if you're not getting the butterflies, then you've really lost it. It's not right. Even a question of butterflies. I wish I could say, oh, I've nailed it. I never make mistakes in sales anymore. I make 3 or 4 a week at least, often in conversations I'm wishing really I hadn't been kind of off, and being willing and aware of the idea that there's almost never such thing as a perfect sales conversation, in the same way as human beings. When was the last time, do we ever grade our conversations as human beings?
Yeah.
Did you ever finish a conversation with someone and hang up the phone and go, wow, that was a perfect conversation?
No. Or, okay. Or a podcast interview.
Oh, thanks.
Pressure's on. Oh, no. So you work in the government contracting arena. You're a consultant, right? And you help people figure out how to win government contracts. And the big thing that sticks out about you with me is you talk about how when you deal with the government, you're dealing with a person, just reminding people of that. And the key is relationships. I really like that.
And that was the very essence of how we met. When you were in your last job as director of small business programs for the Navy, you and I connected as people. It wasn't just, oh, I was running a program for the National Veterans Small Business Coalition and I needed a speaker from an agency. I got to meet you. And I got to know you, and we got to be friends.
Yes.
And even though you were just about to head into a career transition, we stayed friends. Mm-hmm. And that experience of meeting people and getting to know them and getting to be friends, that doesn't sound too awful, is it? We've really enjoyed getting to know each other, and I can hardly wait for whatever adventures we have ahead. Now, you can't necessarily expect to be going on adventures with your federal contracting clients and buddies, but sometimes you never know where life takes you. And thinking about people that you meet in business, rather than thinking of them as prospects, just taking a step back and saying, hey, I'm dealing with another human being. That's revolutionary for a lot of people in the government contracting realm. And that's my professional swim lane. And yeah. So a lot of the things that I've discovered in my adventure in what I call the heart of darkness of federal sales probably are just as relevant to anybody in any kind of job that involves sales. But the federal happens to be where I live. And in the same way as with any business, pretty much, if you say, I sell to everybody or everybody needs what I do, well, the advice I give my clients is focus or go broke. So federal happens to be the swim lane I'm in. And it turns out that it's a place where there's so many people that have incredible passion and ideas, innovations, and they want nothing more than to bring those things to the language that comes out of their mouths is federal agencies, but really to the federal human beings who need what they do. But in order to make that difference, you run into the field of dreams myth. If you build it, they will come. Do you remember the movie? Yeah, and they don't. And so ultimately you discover that either you as the business owner or the person who's tasked with sales, you've got to cross that bridge. You've got to embrace and master everything in what's involved in sales, which just brings up so many negative connotations for a lot of people right out of the box, doesn't it?
Yeah, and why does it have to? I mean, I read one of Daniel Pink's books. It was like everybody's in sales. And I went to hear him speak about that. And he was talking about it. We're all, you know, sales is influencing, right? And we're all in that. We're influencing, you know, I've watched my 4-year-old grandson. I'm at my son's house tonight. I've watched him influence his parents quite often.
You make a really profound point. Any of us who are saying, well, gee, I don't do sales. Lots of people say that. And the things involved in human connection, in influencing, these are things that we are built as humans to do from being tiny babies.
Yeah.
And there's a upside and a downside to that, because it also is at the root of why I know I and so many of us, millions of us, struggle and avoid and get really uncomfortable with the idea of sales. And when we're tiny babies, we are wired as little creatures to connect with our caregivers, to make sure, do our best to make sure that somebody's going to love us and care for us and take care of us, because the fate, our fate if we're rejected. That's right down on Maslow's bottom of the pyramid. That's a profound survival skill. And so, but our wiring for that as humans to fear, have a deep fear of rejection, have that visceral reaction to not doing something that will get us rejected, that's wired in as a survival response in our DNA. And shaking that off as we become adults and understand what really is a life threat and what's not,
right,
is really challenging. And that's part of it, the root of it. Let me try this.
You got a door opening and shutting.
I do.
It's okay. Don't worry about it.
I won't. And when I talk to clients, I tried this as an experiment. It worked really, really well. Take a second. And when you think about the negative things about sales, what words come up for you? Just dish. What words come up? Think of all the negative things that just spring to mind as soon as someone says, and what else?
You know, just trying to get me to buy something.
Keep going.
I don't know. What happens if they say no? You know, they don't really care about me. They just want me to buy something. Mm-hmm. They don't know me. They don't know my needs. All they care about is selling something.
All right. Got it. Very, very mainstream responses. Now, take a step back and think differently about, think about somebody that you know who has been the one who goes on the company trip to Maui, the Golden Circle, the million dollar club, the pink Cadillac. Do you know somebody that either has, they really are at the top of their profession in every way, in whatever industry they sell, or someone you've done business with for years? You buy something from this person, you always go back to this person. Maybe it's they offer a product or a service, maybe it's life insurance, maybe it's your hairdresser. Why do you, that person, you always go back to them. They're your person. There's a transaction. You choose to purchase their expertise or services. Think about at least one person like that. Just tell me their qualities.
Well, I do know that my financial advisor, I met him in Southern Maryland, and he
was, what's he like?
Edward Jones. Oh, and I didn't go with him right away. It took probably a couple of years. But he's just very personable. He's not pushy. He knows about, you know, different things about my family. I mean, we have a good relationship, a good bond, and don't feel pushy.
What do you like about him? He offers financial services. What do you like about him? Why did you pick him?
He cares. He cares. Mm-hmm. And that's clear because of some of the ways he explains things. You know, he's not trying to pull the wool over my eyes. He explains and he asks questions and he doesn't want me to just take it on faith. You know, he explains things. Yeah. And he's very personable. It makes you feel at ease.
I see you smile. I just feel the warmth that you have when you just think of him, you picture him in your mind's eye, your whole body relaxes. You go, oh, I'm going to spend time with him.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That experience. I love the quote from Dr. Maya Angelou. People will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. And to be able to give somebody the experience you just described, to be able to listen, explain something, not be in a hurry. That person took their time. It was going to take them 2 years. It was going to take them 2 years. But are you probably ever going to change financial advisors?
No.
No, that's right. They have had all the time in the world to get to know you. And that's a really deep human connection. And that is really the essence of what sales is all about and what most of us never think of up front, do we?
No. And Jose says, he said, pushy. And then he said, I love that he provides value and assists in providing your needs. Yeah. And Jeannie said, I love that quote. Yep. It's so true. You never forget how people make you feel. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the sales has a lot of different things going on. And sometimes the objectives of sales kind of crash into each other. As business owners, tell me if this feels familiar. You have expertise, but I wish we could stop using this phrase, you eat what you kill. Nobody's killing anyone in sales. And yet the idea, you know that there are consequences you can have all the goals you like, but depending on your personal situation and how many employees you have, what your income sources are, there's a lot at stake when you contemplate, what if I don't close the sale? What if this person doesn't buy from me? What if that person doesn't buy from me? The possible outcomes, a possible negative outcome is so loaded in our heads with, oh, between everything from, oh, I'm going, it's one thing to fail at Sudoku. It's another thing to fail to achieve your goal in a conversation with another human. You get to fail in public. You get to, if your mental wiring lets you, you can decide that you're humiliated. You can feel threatened that, oh good, there's another source of income that's not coming. That can threaten everything from the feeling of domestic bliss if someone in your household was counting on a vacation or assistance for college to longer term retirement, to paying your bills, to paying your employees. That's a lot of stuff hanging on a yes or a no, isn't it?
Yeah.
And so somehow the idea that, oh, just relax, really? On what planet? Yeah. It's really not, it's not just a game of mindset and flipping a switch. And it's everything about sale. I had all of those negative attitudes about sales when I came out of business school. I wanted to be a strategist. I just, like so many of the folks in government contracting and lots of business owners, we want to share our expertise. We want to help people. And yeah, we could do that all day long. The selling, could somebody please do that for me? And could somebody please just line up needy people and I'll serve them? Funny how that doesn't happen. And so we disconnect the idea of service from engagement when looking at it another way. What if sales, all the things involved in sales and marketing, that's wooing in very human connection terms. And we know how to do that too. Smile for the stranger, giggle, see if we can get a cookie. I mean, I have to joke that I was speaking in public from the point where I got wandered off from the family picnic and got lost in Gage Park, and my parents found me trying to talk to little old ladies who are probably younger than I am now out of their sandwiches. Mm-hmm. And so just talking to people and relaxing in getting to know them, that can seem like the last thing on your mind when the big objective you got in mind is sell. And yet setting yourself up so you've got good research, good process, you're not all over the place. You can keep showing up and be relaxed and know that if this person isn't your right person, that's okay. You've built some good prospecting around that. You can take all the time you like. One of my favorite clients, I went back because I always go back and look at the records, and I think I was involved in back and forth conversations with Fran Lardison, just like with your financial advisor, for 2 years. Did I give up? Nope. He was involved in something very cool, 3D printing and additive manufacturing. And there's a change in the company and this and that and the other thing. And we just kept in touch. And then when the time finally came to work together, this was one of the most remarkable teams that I've ever worked with. Everybody was on the same page, and they actually renewed our engagement after we finished our 8-week program and said, we want to work with you for another 6 months. We want to work with you regularly. We want to keep building our practice, keep staying in practice using the techniques that we've learned, because the things that I'm teaching them are some of the things that I learned when, after avoiding everything to do with sales for over 25 years, I was slammed metaphorically right up against it, and I didn't have any choice but really had to figure it out.
And Sam says, you know, he calls it rifle shot versus shotgun. Yeah,
there's that. Yeah, that's one part of it. And you can afford to, I don't want to think about it in terms of hunting. My friend Will Randolph talks about hunting, fishing, farming. He's got a wonderful broadcast as well, talking about that as a big theme. And we can talk about it in those kinds of terms as well. But in building relationships, you don't make a whole conference room of people fall in love with you. You're doing business with one person at a time. And so I got out of business school. This was in 1984, and the computer industry was about on the edge of an enormous change. The PC was coming off the slab, out of the lab in Boca Raton, the face of computing was changing forever. The big excitement was Tracy Kidder's soul of a new machine and mini computing and the vax. For those of us who are in IT, you're giggling. Some of us remember these things.
Yeah.
When hard drives were sort of outboard things like a toaster and maybe. And so I was really excited out of business school to get a job working for IBM because IBM was hiring business graduates hand over fist. They must have hired about 100 of us at IBM Canada in Toronto, where I was. And they told us I was going to get to do business strategy. I was going to help people build their businesses by harnessing the power of computing and helping them with their business strategy. It took me 6 months to figure out that I was employed by the planet's largest sales organization.
Do you think that there's a reason they didn't use the term sales, but they used business strategy?
I don't know. I was just so excited to have a job. And then I went through IBM basics. It was basic sales training. The S was right there. Nobody hit it. And it was hard. And so I knew for sure that I didn't want to be a marketing rep, be the person on quota. The whole business about quota, the way that it was set up then, was that you got 50% of your salary and then everything else, it was on the draw. You were borrowing from the company against future commission. And if you didn't earn your commission, then if, as I understood, then you owed that money back to the company. That was really scary. I still remember being in one of the branch meetings and the branch chief said, there is nothing I like better than a freshly minted marketing rep with a big quota, a fat mortgage, and a new baby. And I went,
that's hard to do sales.
There are some people. There are some people. I can still picture Jim Perkins who found that just exciting and energizing. I knew that was not me. And so at IBM, I wanted to be able to be in a company, be in a place where I could rise to the top of whatever organization that was. And the culture of IBM was all about sales. And so you look at who rose to the top in the company. And you could be the very best systems engineer you wanted to be, but the people who rose to the top, the people who were revered, the people who had all the status, were the people who were the marketing reps, who became marketing managers, who could drive quota, who could do that sales thing. Now, I've also heard people say, hey, if you couldn't find a job that you wanted at IBM, then you just didn't want to work for IBM. There were probably a lot of jobs that I could do. But being in an organization that was fundamentally a sales culture left me feeling like that wasn't my home. It wasn't going to be right for me. So I applied for jobs at the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. I wanted to be making a big difference on a big stage somewhere else, anywhere else, anything. So I kid that I was so horrified of sales that I literally left the country. All kinds. I was looking for something complete. It took me about 2 years to figure out what did I want to do. People were kind, let me do interest interviews. I got a lot of rejection letters. I really wanted to be part of a young professionals program at the World Bank. I was crushed to get that rejection letter. But somebody else suggested I file a resume and a cover letter at the Canadian Embassy in Washington, D.C. And I did that and I interviewed and I failed. And I went down and I filed paperwork for another position and that got filled internally. By the time they got around to the third row, that I'd figured out how the interview system worked. And I knew that they were going to ask all these questions and I needed to be able to basically set them up and knock them down. Do you do this? Yes, I can do this. Have you got experience doing that? Yes, I do. Sort of like an RFP, like the structure of government stuff. And so I had managed to go and do just enough research at the last minute, talking to somebody who had worked elsewhere in that part of the Canadian government and memorized just enough stuff to blow the doors off the interview board and ace the interview. It took me years to relearn all the stuff that I memorized just long enough to get the interview. But in 1987, suddenly, in the fund in 1987, I had a job offer at the Canadian Embassy in Washington, D.C. at the Trade Commissioner Service. And so I left my home, my native land, my family, the computer industry, packed up everything. And oh yeah, and got married. And because I was also in a relationship that was heading in that direction. And we'd gotten engaged without either of us knowing who was moving north and who was moving south. We just knew that February 13th in 1988 was when we were getting married and everything else would be fine. As it turned out, we were lucky it worked out that way. And so I started my job at the Canadian Embassy. And my job was to help Canadian companies win contracts with the U.S. federal government under the newly inked Canada-U.S. Free Trade Agreement. Oh. So that was how I started to learn my profession. People would call me up and ask about anything from international traffic in arms regulations, stuff that nobody was ever going to be able to solve their problem. The answer was no, forget it. And right. something as simple as the predecessor to how do I register in SAM or what's a GSA schedule? And I didn't know from one day to the next whether this was something anybody could solve, something that a little research could solve or a completely hopeless case. So every single day the phone would ring and I had to know the answer. I didn't have a clue. And it had to be right.
That's a great way to learn.
It was. And I'm not somebody who enjoys researching just for the fun of it. I like to research and be somebody's superhero. So it was a great way to become that, do that consulting thing that I had wanted to do. And I didn't have to sell, sort of. It was interesting. I got to do what I call market evangelism. I spent my first wedding anniversary on Her Majesty's Not Especially Secret Service on a 14-stop roadshow going across Canada, talking to Canadian companies about how the trade agreements worked and the things they would need to do if they wanted to win contracts with the U.S. federal government fairly and under the agreements. I had to talk for 25 minutes and take 5 minutes worth of questions, which was perfect because I only knew 31 minutes worth of anything, but it was 31 minutes more than they did. But I avoided sales, which was great.
Right.
I had a lot of fun in the job. I hit a point, the job I had was never intended to be, I wasn't part of the career foreign service. There's all kinds of things about hierarchy and different kinds of jobs. But after 15 years of growing to be Canada's top expert in U.S. federal acquisition, as in terms of industry advice, I kind of ran out of creative room. It was time to move on. In 2003, I left the staff of the Canadian Embassy and launched my business. Summit Insight.
Made your multi-million-dollar mistake when you launched your business, not when you were at the Canadian.
Yes, I did not make the multi-million-dollar mistake at the Canadian Embassy. Okay. At the Canadian Embassy, I helped over 5,000 companies win when they added it up, the total amount of sales that they credited our help with assisting them with was over $200 billion over 15 years. I thought I knew stuff. It turns out I didn't know nearly as much as I thought, and especially not about some really important stuff. So my business was kind of successful. You know, when you first start a business, you're doing business with people you know, people you like, people who know you.
Decided to leave and start a business. You just felt like you had...
Well, I think I wanted to be able to work more creatively and in more depth than I could have if I had stayed.
All right.
And I'd been really fortunate at the embassy. In some ways, I had had maverick managers, people who gave me a lot of rope, let me do some really extraordinary and fun things. And I hit a point where I had realized that I had just simply been lucky to have a string of maverick managers, but that wasn't necessarily going to happen all the time. And my ability to do more interesting and expansive creative things turned out to be really pretty limited. And the upside about running your own business is the world's your oyster. You can do all kinds of things. You got to take some risks and you got to invest and you got to do a lot of other things. But somebody also has to say yes in order, if your objective as a business owner includes to generate profit for some reason, then you also have to be able to clear your expenses. You have to be able to sell. And at the beginning, I was the only person in the Canadian government who did what I did. So Canadian government offices would hire me to do kind of some of the same stuff that I'd left. My model, I thought that I knew that right away, I did, right out of leaving the embassy, I didn't really have the expertise to advise American companies, but I figured Canadian companies would value the expertise they couldn't get from me working at the embassy anymore. Well, not so much. So they were the people that I was working with, the pool I knew how to fish in, were people who are used to getting services from the government for free. So working with individual companies was kind of hit or miss, but to be absolutely blunt, think about the kinds of things that most government contractors really want somebody to help them do. I knew from my time at the embassy that the thing people wanted most was they wanted you to give them a contract. Well, I couldn't do that. Second best thing, they wanted me to introduce them to somebody else who was going to give them a contract. That's work only they could do. They wanted someone to sell for them. Well, I wasn't going to do that. They wanted someone who could write proposals. I wouldn't write proposals if you paid me. It's not because proposals are not important. I'm not any good at them. Mm-hmm. So that while writing proposals, I wasn't going to do that. And I wasn't going to sell. And those are two big things you hire people to do. Now, I love making presentations and explaining how the federal market worked and all kinds of other stuff. And at the point, by the time I got to about 7 years after I started my company, I finally got past the who do you think you are demons and gathered together lots of useful stuff that I had learned over not only over my time at the embassy, but then being in the trenches every day and running my own business. And so I wrote the first edition of my book, Government Contracts Made Easier. That it's easier because easy is fiction. And so that was one of my two procurement jokes. And so
the link to get your book, Government Contracts Made Easier. And you also have a workbook that goes with it, right?
Thank you. Yeah. At the first edition of the book, it was bringing together everything I'd learned up until about 2010. And at that point, by the time I got to kind of 2012, 2014, I could tell you anything you wanted to know about how the federal government does business, anything at all, except for one little thing, how someone actually closed the business. It wasn't that I didn't want to tell you. I honestly didn't know, which didn't matter very much till the day that it really, really did. So my business had struggled, little contract here, little contract there. And then I landed what for me, for my business was the big one. I was going to have a work with 7 companies for a whole year and help them do their strategy. Yay. Their sales plan. I could hire somebody for help for that. And I was going to consult with them for a whole year. These companies were doing everything from one had generators that could power a campus or a city block. Another one had waterless shampoo, perfect for hospitals beds. Another one had snap lock glass containers. Another one had uninterruptible power supplies. Another one had root canal equipment.
Totally different.
Dental supplies. But you know, but that was going to be all right. I had a buddy. I had known her about 10 years ago, my friend Eileen Kent. Mm-hmm. And so I said, Eileen, I need your help with this thing, the sales plan thing. She said, great, here's what it costs. I said, can I see it first? She said, nope. She said, nope. You mean I'm going to pay you thousands of dollars sight unseen, you're going to do the thing? She said, yep. I said, do me. Wow. And this was the best decision I ever made for more reasons than I realized at the time. So you ever have one of those contracts where you do lots of the heavy lifting up front and then it's just kind of smooth sailing for the, yeah, this was that contract. I went, great. This was my contract for the whole year. And it was going to be regular income. How wonderful for any business owner, predictable income. It felt so good. It felt so safe. And we got to the end of delivering the sales plans, providing the training for all these companies. And I said, okay, we're done. I'll see you next week. Make some calls. They said, wonderful. When are you making the introductions? I said, the what? The introductions. And I went, no. They said, yeah. No. I said, yep. And I went through shock and anger and denial and all the stages of grief. And it wasn't even a question of misunderstanding of scope of work. We're not even going to go there. At the end of the day, I had to take a deep breath and pull up my big girl socks and open the sales plan, pick up the phone. I was terrified.
Wow.
I only had 3 problems.
Had to make those introductions because these people were under contract with you. You could have refunded them.
No, not at this point. And so, I mean, I was on the hook for literally thousands of calls, hundreds of introductions for 7 companies for a whole year. Now, here were my problems. First, I had never done this before. I was terrified that everybody would think I was a big fat fraud. I'd written a book. How could I not know this?
Right.
Second, I have a graduate degree. I don't do sales. Yeah, that ship had sailed. But I really, in the words of the immortal Gene Kranz, mission controller, failure was not an option. This was my contract for the whole year. I had never let down a client before, and I wasn't going to do it. So I picked up the phone, and it was awful. Can you imagine me being lost for words? Yeah, right.
No.
I stammered and I didn't know what to say and I was awkward and they were kind. I was confused. They didn't mind these people I was calling. I thought, well, what am I so afraid of? Well, I thought, what's the worst thing that can happen? Somebody could yell at me. That happens. Someone snarled at me exactly once and said, don't ever call me again. All right. We paint that line in the sales plan gray. we don't call him again. But I'm calling public servants. I'm calling people who are here to serve me as a taxpayer. They're in these jobs because they want to serve. They have responsibility to serve. How bad could it really get? So call after call after call after call. I had a sales plan. This saved me. But I had a methodical way to at least find out something about people. But at the end of the day, I was dialing for dollars for endodontics. I love it. And I hit the turning point when I was talking to Dr. Ned Robertson, the endodontist with the Indian Health Service in Penobscot, Maine. And this is about our third conversation. He was talking about his nephew who was going to be graduating from Georgetown Medical School. He was so excited. And what he was doing on his Tuesday off, you know what he was doing on his Tuesday off?
No.
Sewing curtains. And he said, oh, those guys from B&L Biotech, sure, no problem. Set up a call. And he hung up the phone. I went, that was it? That was all I had to do? Okay, I'm going to take a little break. I can do this again. And pick the phone and dial again. And so this was a full year project. And at the end of this project, I thought, I am never going to do this again. I'm never going to do a project with this much reporting again. But I'm never going to tell a single soul I know. Wait a second. I cannot be the only person who has expertise and who struggles with this whole thing about sales. There have got to be other companies that a methodical way to do this and some support to stay in gear and keep doing it would make all the difference. I call up my friend Eileen. Say, Eileen, can we do this again? She says, sure. And over the next 5 years, we ended up working with easy 50, 60 companies in that period of time and taking them through these steps. And some people would, nobody ever said it was a stupid approach. It didn't work. I did have some people who would say, I didn't do the, this is tactically brilliant. I didn't do the work. I got to own that. I said, All right, well, how do we fix that part? And so over the last 3 years, I really wanted to figure this out. Because for me, for somebody to hire me and not get the result they really wanted, that really bothered me. That was hitting my big not good enough button in a really curious way. And I piloted not one, not three, but five different programs. And at the end of that, I put them all back on the shelf and said, what did we learn from this? And we pulled out the missing piece, because the three things that people needed to do to be successful, they needed to understand the federal sales game, what it was that each people at each layer conceptually needed and cared about, so you could have some idea of where to start a conversation. They needed to get research done. They needed a plan. But they also needed to have whatever it took to stay engaged. And what was so scary about that? And figuring that out and being able to get people genuinely excited about what it means to build human connection, that teaching, understanding that art form and being able to teach that is now the core of my practice. And a lot of the other things from other parts of personal development and understanding human connection have come into play. So my toolkit for doing that is maybe 10% federal acquisition regulations and 90% understanding how to get past the things that stop us from connecting with each other as human beings who just happen to be in the federal arena together.
Wow. So you're saying that, why would you say then that it's a multimillion-dollar mistake?
Because failure to understand how to have a conversation with other people. I didn't know how to do that very well for my own business. I didn't know how to do that well enough to help somebody else. But my revenue for my company struggled and struggled and struggled. And I could have even just $100,000 of revenue for 10 years solid. I could have had more than that. You know, do the math, the revenue that I could have been generating for my company, if only I had, instead of quailing from and running from the idea of what sales really was all about, if I had learned that art for my own company a lot sooner, my company would have been more profitable. And I can only begin to imagine the difference. I didn't even do that math, the difference I could have been making for companies who otherwise liked me, but I didn't have anything to offer because I couldn't tell them how to solve this one problem. So that was the multi-million-dollar mistake. And that was a hard piece of math to realize, but to just say, well, that's over. Look ahead. Now that I have mastered enough of this to almost feel like I'm at the starting line, it feels joyful and exciting. And it's really changing the groups and teams who come and work with me because I've realized the particular approach that I take. It's one thing I haven't figured out is a methodical way to bring that and offer that in a structured way so people will do the work as individuals. The thing that I particularly, the point that I'm at now, I'm really having amazing success in working with small teams and individual companies because people support each other. There may be something, and you and I both know of great coaching programs where people are working together in pods or small groups. So there's a lot of juice in small groups. That part I haven't quite figured out. But you were asking me about the micro engagement. And so this is really cool. And I haven't really talked to anyone else about this. You think about I draw on some of the work of Brené Brown, and one of the elements that comes out of her earliest work has to do with foundations of how trust is built. And trust is built one small interaction at a time. You probably couldn't count the number of conversations you had with your financial advisor before you finally said yes, right?
Right. That's true.
Yeah. And so often in sales positions, we're hoping to make 3 phone calls and could they please buy, right? And the only way we can keep showing up and having conversations with people is if we've chosen well, we can keep showing up with energy, determination, resilience. We're not going to get deterred by no, because what comes after no and no and no and no is now.
Yeah, but sometimes it's not the right time. It's not necessarily me or you, the person, you know, that has the product or service to sell. It's just not the right time, or there's could be numerous reasons, but we tell ourselves in our head that it's all, we make it all about us when it's not all about us.
No, so much is not. The one of the elements of trust that I like, Brené Brown's work, it acronyms out to braving. And so boundaries, reliability, accountability, the vault, confidentiality, integrity, non-judgmentality, and the G, which I love, and I trip over this every day pretty much, generosity. What's the first thing you think and the second and the third thing you think when somebody doesn't return your call?
They don't like me.
There you go. Keep going.
They don't want to talk to me. Yeah. They don't like me. They, you know, they must be mad at me. But I know that a lot of times when I didn't return someone's call when I was working for the Navy, it was just because it got buried in my to-do list. I wanted to, and I just didn't get around to it sometimes, or an email would get buried, or it would go to my junk mail. So there's so many other reasons why I didn't get back to that person.
Yeah. And the same is true now with anybody who doesn't return your call from your coaching business. And that's so hard to remember, isn't it? The only thing we can know, and I want everyone who's ever been discouraged or tired in a sales job and the calls are hard to make, the only thing you can know when somebody doesn't return your call is they didn't return your call. And so it's a wonderful quiz to do. And it's a challenge your team and ask them and realize until you talk to them, you can't know. All you can do is keep showing up with determination. People are afraid of being thought to be a pest. And I love the idea of remembering that most people, the vast majority of people with some kind of sales responsibility, give up after about 2 or 3 calls. And it takes between 15 and 30 instances of contact to get from contact to contract, 15 to 30.
Wow. And so you have to be like a people person, an extrovert, in order to be good at sales, good at that?
Actually, no, that's not the deal. And business owners ask me all the time, you know, they'll say, I need to hire somebody from sales. I'm going, actually, maybe not. In your company, who are the people in your company that they know all about the company? They are passionate about your company. They love what you do. People enjoy spending time with them. Now, that's not the happy-go-lucky, buy drinks in the bar person. It's people just love being around Sarah. Mm-hmm. They just do. And Sarah has all the time in the world for people, listens well, and is patient. All those characteristics you talked about, your financial advisor loves to explain things. really slowly, cares about people. That's your person. And that when that person's inside your company, anything that is specific about federal, that's a learnable skill. The part that you, it's really hard to parachute in somebody from outside when they don't have the passion for your company. They don't know the things that are going on for your company and what's special about your culture, your approach, the unique way you've evolved your product or your service. If they don't care about those things, and then care about the people that they're having conversations with, then you're going to struggle. But often the person who's right for that job is right inside the company.
When I went to see that Daniel Pink lecture, somebody had asked, it was a couple years ago, so it's hard to remember everything, but somebody had asked him a question, and he said, a lot of people make a mistake. They think that they have to go hire an extrovert to be the person to do sales. And that doesn't necessarily mean that being an extrovert doesn't necessarily make you somebody who's going to excel at sales. We've failed to look at all the other things like what you just mentioned.
Yeah. And you want somebody who embodies the values of the company. One of the things that I've noticed of the teams that I've been working with over the last couple of years, particularly, they're cohesive. They're not all family-owned companies, but they've got a really strong culture. Mm-hmm. And people care about the mission and purpose of the company. And the mission and purpose mm-hmm. of the company is aligned with helping a federal department or agency achieve their mission. So they are passionate about public service from the other side of the public-private right. sector divide. And so they make good partners. They're wired for support and for caring about the mission. And that shines. That comes through. Often, a lot of the people I work with, not all, many of the business owners are veterans, either the business owners or people on the team, and or people who have been federal employees. And so they also speak the language, but also embody the culture. And it's different from, I just hired somebody who is a senior executive at that agency, and now I'm going to plop them into a sales position, and they're going to just bring all their friends. No. That can be successful, but it often is not. I hear more stories from folks who don't have a great experience with that. Again, because for the same reason as you can't really, in a lot of organizations, not just the federal government, parachute in from the top, get the big boss to like you and get pushed down the hall and plopped in front of some. Yeah, you can't do that.
I mean, I remember when I worked for the government and, a retired, senior person, SES or admiral or general would come in with the contractor. And it's like, they can't tell us what to do. And it's just, people name drop. That doesn't go over very well.
I don't like that at all.
When you come in at the top, it's not always the top that are the people making the decisions on the type of procurement, what it is that you're selling. It's usually the GS 13 or 14 level that are making those decisions on, how on the acquisition strategy and stuff like that. It's not the senior level.
Yeah. And so we talked about the flip side of multimillion-dollar mistake. And a lot of this has, when I made the latest transition into depth of really understanding the things that people needed and that made the difference when they're trying to build their federal business, win the work. It breaks down into not only understanding what the goal is of the person that you want to have for a client or a customer, because their goal may be different from yours.
Right.
You want to sell the thing. You want to help them with their mission. Their personal and professional goals, what's important to them? And that may vary depending on whether the goals of the stakeholder are different from the goals of the end user, and they're different from the goals of the small business specialist. So the goals of each of the players at each of the layers is going to be different. The milestones on the way to those goals, think about a jar with rocks in it or marbles in it. All right, visualize that. And so Brené Brown's metaphor is that every single thing that you do, small thing to build trust, you're putting a marble in the trust jar. I take that one step further. Now imagine a jar that's packed to the rim with marbles. Okay. Can you imagine it?
Mm-hmm.
Now, is that jar full? And you can run your hand across the top. You can feel the tops of the marbles.
No.
Is the jar full?
No.
Why not?
Because you can pour sand in it.
there's spaces between the marbles. I remember Mr. Macchione did this in grade 10 physics class, and we thought then it's full. And then he poured water in over top and went, oh, boy, why couldn't we figure that out? And but you think about those tiny grains of sand. The metaphor for that, if the jar, filling the jar is the goal and the marbles are the milestones on the way, the grains of sand are what I call micro engagements. Micro engagements. So often it's a long haul in the federal market from October 1st to September 30th. You get nothing, push, spend. Oh, we won something, or we didn't, worse yet. And it can feel really hard and discouraging. And so, and that's true with any big goal, isn't it? Now, sometimes if you want to do something like lose weight, you can, like, at least you're watching, you've got something you can monitor. A lot of our big goals, we're going, if you're working for a larger company, did you sell anything yet? Did you win anything yet? Did you win anything yet? How awful. We don't set ourselves up with figuring out what are the milestones. What are our milestones that are important on the way to winning the thing? But what are the milestones that are important for our federal humans? And the milestones for a stakeholder are going to be different from the milestones for the small business specialist, are going to be different from the milestones for the end user. But they're all working to achieve goals, not just for their agency, but in their own careers as well. Mm-hmm. And so what would it feel like to think about when you look at people that you want to get to know and think about what's important to them? Let's say you look them up on LinkedIn and somebody has just been in the job they're in that agency for maybe 4 months. And you think about what's important to that person if they've been in that job for 4 months. Think about it. You've been in your job as director of Navy Small Business Programs for 4 months, Emily. What's on your mind?
A good job.
What else?
Doing the job and, you know, getting to know the people on your team, you know, and you don't know all the answers, but you kind of want to be able to know all the answers. Yeah.
Yeah. So somebody, you think about that when you look and see somebody's in a new position and they haven't been there that long. Yeah. What can you do to help them? You know lots of things about your subject matter expertise. If you've been scooting around that agency for a while, you may know people they mm-hmm. need to know. They also want to feel smart. Mm-hmm. You can ask them, how does this thing work? We're new here too. We're new. Explain to us how things work. This may give them, remember like ICE is saying at the Canadian Embassy, when somebody asked me a thing, I needed to find out. That gave me a reason to go and get to know things better. Sometimes I had to understand something well enough to explain it to somebody else. Asking that person, hey, we just want to follow proper protocol. What's yours? How does it work here? And you're giving them the opportunity to learn and to feel smart. It gives you the opportunity to go back and say to their management, hey, Chuck did an amazing job explaining this to me. He made it possible for us to avoid some mistakes and not bid on something that didn't make any sense and not waste our time on this other thing. He was great. That goes in Chuck's permanent file. Emily, when somebody wrote a letter and said, Emily did the most amazing job, do they look at that when it's promotion time?
Well, I don't know that they look at it, but it sticks in their head. They remember. I mean, those kinds of things are remembered. What's the, we got to wrap it up.
Jean. Oh my goodness.
What's the, so what is the key to joy in
entrepreneurship? The key to joy in entrepreneurship, if the one thing that I've discovered that now in, that makes, is making my days just so much better, is that I take my time when I'm getting to know someone and say, what's your story? I love asking, how did you get in the place you are? How did you, I was asked, and just learn the time mm-hmm. that you take, instead of going, how fast can I sell something? Slow down, get to know what's happening for that person. Once you start to listen to what's happening for them, they'll tell you all kinds of things that'll get you thinking, wow, what do I know? Who do I know that could be helpful for them? You're having the conversation in the first place because you figured out maybe this is somebody that you can help, and just to slow down and work at the micro engagement level. And you get to fill the whole jar, and you get to build such solid trust that the people you're working with will want to be with you forever, and they'll bring their friends.
That's a really good, like, just that picturing that jar and all the little things that you can do to fill it for that one customer.
Long before we talk about micro ingredients, not even micro purchase, but to recognize those grains of sand, what small difference could I make for somebody today so that every time you call, they know something great's going to happen. Emily called me. I got to return Emily's call. Sam called. Sam is amazing.
That's happened lately with me with COVID, you know, just meeting different people on Zoom. You know, you connect with somebody on LinkedIn and you meet with them on Zoom and then, you know, you have a little bit something in common. So then I could say, oh, you should meet Judy or you should meet that person. Even just an introduction, putting a grain of sand in that jar, right?
It is. And you think I've been thinking about marketing and sales as acts of service. You want to give somebody the same experience, the same quality of experience as they're getting to know you, as you understand that they can expect when they engage you. If you're having a crummy time on the date and you figure it'll be better if you pay somebody money and engage them, not really. You know, if you're thinking of buying some big database or engaging some fancy consultant and your call isn't getting returned and nobody's helping you with tech support, you think that's going to be better when you pay? Not so much, probably. Right. I've had that experience lots of times. I've bought thousands of dollars of hope and only I could get back a fraction of it, but that I lesson. You got to learn it over and over again. Notice, so give people that glorious experience right up front that you want to give them when you're really engaged.
Right. So that's how people can email you, judy.bradt, B-R-A-D-T, at growfedbiz.com. And you have a blog. What do you blog about?
This is my personal blog. So this is really special. I set myself a challenge to really be able to be authentic, to talk about the stuff going on for me. So this is your chance, if you're listening, to get a sense of what I'm about. And by putting this out there, a little like when you said I was launching a podcast, so I am. I'm putting this out there so that I'm also going to make the commitment to keep on contributing to that blog, because being vulnerable, finding that sweet spot, that's a messy gray zone between all shiny and armored up and flaming hot mess. There's no perfect line you got to walk. It's a gooey place and it's imperfect. And our willingness to be like that with each other is what leaves us able and willing to connect and muddle through together.
Yeah. And then we've got your website, growfedbiz.com. The name of your company is
Insight. Grow Fed Biz is easier to remember, and you don't have to tell anybody how to spell it.
And that's your book, Government Contracts Made Easier. And you have a workbook that you put out too.
I do. I did the second edition to clean up all the links and all that, but thousands of companies love the book, even if they're not in a position to be able to hire me or work with my company. And it's an Amazon number one bestseller. I'm really proud of that.
Oh, you should be. It's a good book. It's great.
Thank you for it.
And then you had talked about Brené Brown. So you wanted to.
Whether you are a solopreneur or you've got a team, the things that Brené Brown brings together in Dare to Lead have critical principles, not only for building a high trust organization. And research shows that high trust organizations are also higher performing organizations. But her work is both easy to understand and takes a lifetime to live, and well worth it. So I love this book and materials. There's lots of free materials on the website as well. So I recommend it really strongly to all of my clients and my friends.
And we read that. Judy's in the Onward Movement that I lead. And that's from time to time we've read books, and that's one of the books that we read and we discussed it.
And I can't say enough good about the other thing that you're talking about in the Onward Movement, positive intelligence. I'm so excited to be starting to learn that. And as I master that and get to understand it better, to also start recommending that and working that into the next level of depth and building connection. Because there's things about how we're built as humans that Shehrzad Shamin talks about that I can hardly wait to take that to the next level and start to bake that into the programs I'm doing as well.
Yeah, that would be really good to put that in there. Yeah, that's a good program. And I think what he says, what does he say? When you're in that small accountability group, you're like 500 times more likely to learn and to apply what you learn, you know, rather than if you just go to a conference and come back. I mean, how many of us have come back, done this, done that, and then it's we're back to our old habits.
It's practice. And that's one of the reasons why my program is 8 weeks now instead of three, because we get the practice of not just here's your sales plan, good luck, we told you how to do it, but we actually work and get to know 15 individual federal humans as we're going through it. I love the thing that Shirzad talks about, and look it up, mirror neurons, the idea that you and I can pick up each other's energy, people who are watching us. I would love to know, put it in the notes, let us know, how did you feel by the end of watching this conversation? Because that there's that shift that happens, that we pick up energy. And it's also why if you're in a horrible, scary place, don't make the sales call that day. Go get in a better place, because people pick that up from you. And I really noticed that. So I'm really careful and very intentional about how I am ready to connect with and have conversations with and really care about the people I'm talking to, whether or not they decide that now is the time. And I encourage everybody to at least make that commitment anytime you pick up the phone, whether it's for sales or business or anything else.
Yeah, it's definitely true. We pick up on each other's energy. You can hear it on the phone. You can hear stress. Even if you can't see the person, you can feel it. You can just, we have that sense about us where we can feel it. Yep.
And you're, and it was saying, it's not like I've solved this and I know how to do this really well. I tell my clients all the time, I may seem like really energetic, I'm coaching you, I have failed at this three times this week, I'm probably going to fail again. It's just a question of how soon. And I'm just, you pick yourself up and you go, all right, well, what did I learn from that?
So you understand the client, you understand what they're going through. So
I would far sooner try to learn something from somebody who has really struggled with it than someone who seems naturally gifted and go, yeah, well, that was you. How am I going to learn that?
Right.
So, and that's one of the things I like, is to be able to say, I've been there.
Right.
This is something you can do. We're humans. You're just connecting with other people. Everything else is learnable. There's so many people who can hardly wait to learn from us, connect from us, and let us help them make a difference in the world.
Yep. Thank you, Judy, for being on the Onward Podcast. Thanks, Jeannie, Maria, Ellie, Sam, Jose, for watching and commenting. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for inviting me, Emily. I'm honored. It's been wonderful.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Onward Podcast. Please share it with a friend, because as you learned, if you didn't already know, as you learned in this episode, we are all engaged in sales every day. We're also engaged in connecting with other humans every day. And I know for me, that's something I need to kind of work on. I mean, I'm somebody who just likes, let's get the job done, let's get right to it. And I skip the quote unquote small talk. But the small talk is what builds connection. And that's what we talked about in this episode. I'm getting better at that. It takes practice and you can do it. Have a great week, everybody. Thank you for listening. Let's move onward together.